the amount of people over here right now is, I'll say, maybe less than 10% in comparison to the normal time. Because in the normal times, like this plaza over here will be filled.
While many parts of the U.S. are under shelter-in-place orders in an effort to slow the spread of the coronavirus, China is easing some of the restrictions on its citizens. Eager to resume manufacturing, many of China's factories began opening in late February. But now, following 2 months of draconian social distancing measures due to coronavirus, citizens in China are also able to go to the mall and get a haircut. In Beijing, even the Apple stores have reopened. And in Wuhan, considered to be the epicenter of the pandemic, public buses and the subway are finally running again. Meanwhile, in South Korea, people are going to the park and eating out at cafes. The country has been widely praised for significantly slowing the spread of the virus without shutting down businesses or enforcing a lockdown. Instead, South Korea focused on widespread testing and constant tracing of where infected individuals traveled, as well as imposing quarantines for those who were near infection clusters. But fears over a second wave of infections and financial instability may hinder a fast and smooth economic recovery for both countries. In February, China's official but highly doubted urban unemployment rate jumped to 6.2%, its highest on record. This translates to roughly 5 million people out of work. In South Korea, the Seoul government ordered more than 400 hostess bars, nightclubs, and discos in the capital to be shut down amid concerns of coronavirus transmissions. Now, the U.S. and the rest of the world are closely watching as Chinese and South Korean citizens attempt to return to normal life and trying to surmise what the recovery may tell them about their own futures. Just after midnight on April 8th, authorities in Wuhan officially lifted the city's lockdown. The reopening came a day after China reported no new deaths in the city for the first time since January. The occasion was celebrated with a light show as many people went out for the first time in weeks. But although the end of the lockdown gives citizens who can prove that they are healthy a little more freedom to move in and out of the city, life is still far from normal, and fears of the virus coming back are abundant.
The lockdown lift is only meaning that people now can leave Wuhan. So the plane and the train will be resumed, but it doesn't mean we are encouraged to go outside unless we are going to work.
Wuhan is like thought of by the rest of China as the origin of the poison, right? Like we are the start of this pandemic. But people inside of Wuhan are actually scared of people who are coming back from other places as well.
Sadie, who requested that we not use her real name for privacy reasons, was born and raised in Wuhan. She now lives and works in Seattle, but returned to Wuhan to visit her family for Lunar New Year. Sadie said at the height of the lockdown, she spent almost 50 days in her apartment. When she went out again on March 24th, she found a much quieter Wuhan.
My home is in the center of Wuhan, so it's like the most thriving district of Wuhan, and I'm very close to a pedestrian street. It used to be the most thriving street, and it's like full of little vendors and store after store. But on 24th, when I walk on that street, just only delivery guy and cleaning staff over there. And like the real pedestrian is just me.
Even now with the lockdown lifted, authorities still closely track residents' health status and movements.
Subway is open, that's about a week, but not many people are taking it because it's just such a hassle. You need to scan the QR code and report your temperature to get in, and you need to scan again when you board the train to report on which train you are at and which cabin you are in. You want to know all those location information in case there's a confirmed case find later.
Temperature checks and QR codes are also required for those who want to enter malls or even leave their residential buildings. Sadie says that while a number of shops and grocery stores have reopened in the residential streets around her neighborhood, the popular shopping avenues remain mostly quiet. And while restaurants and coffee shops are open, they're still only offering takeout service. Sadie says businesses still need to apply for permission from the government to reopen and to recall their workforce.
there is very detailed policy on that, like what kind of business can resume and what kind of business need to wait. And those kind of businesses that you mentioned, like the bars, the theater, or the gym, they're not allowed to open. So all this business, they need to apply. And unfortunately, those kind of businesses fall in the category of non-essential business at the moment. So they probably need to wait, I don't know, maybe a few more months before they can reopen.
As reported by the New York Times, Wuhan's deputy mayor said in a recent news briefing that nearly 94% of the city's 11,000 businesses have resumed operations. Though smaller businesses may not be so lucky.
A lot of the small businesses went bankrupt, so I don't know if they can ever open again.
But in other aspects of life, there are glimmers of hope, like the old population sitting outside to enjoy a game of cards.
That's how elderly people kill their time. And we start to see that happening again, which I think is a sign of people start to come back to normal life.
In Beijing, signs of bustling city life are coming back, but gradually.
My name's Eunice Yoon, and I am the China correspondent with CNBC based in Beijing. I've been living under a lockdown now for 10 weeks.
Yoon says some of the first businesses to open back up have been factories, but only if they put in place strict prevention measures.
Factory owners that I talked to said that they had to source one mask per worker per day. And when you think about how many factory workers there are in China, that's an enormous number of masks that needed to be sorted. They were also told they had to set up disinfectant showers. They also had to put in place a lot of other measures and mainly for social distancing. So a lot of these factories were able to come online, but only after they put in these prevention measures.
More recently, other businesses that are considered non-essential, like hairdressers and dry cleaners, have also opened up. Yoon says she's also been out to dinner, but even the restaurant experience has changed.
Restaurants are only allowed to have 3 people at a table, and the restaurant that I went to over the weekend had not only hand gel on the table, but also had wrapped up all of the dishes in plastic and had put out an extra set of chopsticks as serving chopsticks, just to make sure that nobody would be using the same chopsticks in the same dishes. So definitely there's a greater awareness of hygiene and concern about the spread of this virus.
Though there are no restrictions on how many people can gather in one area, places where you would normally see large gatherings of people, such as concert halls, have not reopened. Some tourist attractions have reopened, but are limiting admissions. In late March, China ordered the more than 500 theaters that had reopened across the country to close their doors again due to renewed concerns of infection.
I think this really highlights how the reopening of businesses is kind of not a straight line. It's like in starts and fits. And I think it's just because the authorities here, just as authorities are around the world, are trying to balance the idea of rebooting the economy, but at the same time making sure that people are safe because the infection still is spreading.
In late February, South Korea garnered international attention as the country with the largest COVID-19 outbreak outside of mainland China. At its peak on February 29th, medical workers identified 909 new cases in a single day. But since then, South Korea's dramatically flattened its curve. And unlike China, the US, and many European countries, officials did it without completely shutting down the economy.
Seoul was never under lockdown. There was never a mandated shelter-in-place order. There was no kind of fine like we're seeing in some cities around the world, any kind of punishment for leaving your home, but the government was encouraging people to stay indoors unless it was necessary. Doctor's visits, grocery store runs, other necessary trips. They said, do your best to stay indoors. So the public was never locked down, but they did largely stay home.
Some attribute South Korea's efficiency in dealing with the coronavirus to the country's battle with another virus, MERS, or Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, back in 2015. At the time, only 38 people died from MERS, but the virus was a big scare for South Koreans.
Even those numbers really panicked the public back then. And we saw a lot of testing, we saw a lot of mask wearing, we saw a lot of intense hygiene, hand washing, a lot of things we're seeing now around the world, especially in some countries that hadn't really practiced those things before. What I'm trying to say is the country was more prepared than others possibly. And the way the public reacted, I think helped, mitigate the need for a lockdown.
Widespread testing and the tracing of infected people through the help of a government-sponsored smartphone app also helped South Korea keep the virus manageable.
They were using this app to monitor people who had gone into quarantine on the government's instruction to make sure that they didn't leave their self-isolation. And what we saw in some local media reports is that people were leaving their cell phones at home and still stepping outdoors. The government's had enough of that, especially as there's more imported cases in South Korea these days, mainly Koreans returning from the United States or Europe. And the government's now working on getting monitoring bracelets on people who go into self-isolation for 2 weeks.
Another more controversial measure that the government used was to publicly share data about the movements of infected individuals.
I'm talking about somebody tests positive in Seoul, in a certain neighborhood in Seoul, and the government goes back using cell phone records, credit card records, an ATM stop, anywhere your card's been swiped, and they put together a list of places this individual's been, and then they send it out to the public. You get these lists on your cell phone, and there's a link, and it takes you to a website, and you can see where this person's been and what neighborhood. Now, they don't name the individual, but people felt this was a bit of government overreach.
Harrison says that most businesses in Seoul stayed open throughout the outbreak, assuming they could afford it. And many office workers were given the option to go into the office or work from home. But small businesses got hit particularly hard.
I believe from the 1st of March, roughly, until about the 20th, 21st, so roughly 3 weeks, I believe around 1,700 small businesses closed their doors. I interviewed a couple butcher shops, some local grocers, and they were talking about how they'd lost sales, you know, by 50%. And that's because people were taking this quite seriously. Some of these businesses are run by a lot of elderly South Koreans as an alternative to a retirement plan. The pension system here is pretty poor. And even a month of losing a serious amount of income is enough to shutter a small restaurant in this country. A lot of things still aren't back on track. You know, you can't go to a baseball game. They're playing to empty crowds right now. Most athletic events, large gatherings, entertainment, concerts, that's still all on hold. So there is not a sense of normality here. South Korea is not out of the woods by any means.
It's still far too early to predict what long-term impact the coronavirus pandemic may have on the U.S. But some of our leaders have been optimistic about the economy rebounding quickly after we get over the peak.
Now, do you think with this, there's a possibility, if the doctors let us, that we could be open for business in the month of May?
I do, Jim. I think as soon as the president feels comfortable with the medical issues, we are making everything necessary that American companies and American workers can be open for business and that they have the liquidity that they need to operate their business in the interim.
But some experts believe restarting our way of life and the economy will not be as simple as flipping a switch.
It's going to take longer than most of us think to return to normal for two reasons. The first is the virus problem is going to last longer than we think. The fact that new cases have peaked doesn't mean we're over the hump. There's still going to be new cases. There's still uninfected people who don't want to be infected. So the virus thing itself is going to take longer than a lot of us are hoping for or believe. And I think the economy restart is going to take longer than some of us think.
In an interview with CNBC, Bill Gates pointed out that it's not just our pocketbooks that will be affected by this pandemic, but also our psyches.
The behavior of people in terms of wanting to travel or go to events or even go to a restaurant, it's been utterly changed by the concerns about this disease. No one should think the government can wave a wand and all of a sudden, you know, the economy is anything like it was before this happened. That awaits either a miracle therapeutic that has an over 95% cure rate or broad usage of the vaccine. And so, you know, we've had a demand side shock and a supply side shock. And that demand side piece is both mediated by fear of infection and by the overall wealth effects of many people losing their jobs.
In China, the first step to restart normal life has been to put preventative measures in place to help people stay healthy.
Some offices that we go to have disinfectant tents inside the office before you walk into the office. Everybody has to go through temperature checks, or they wear masks, or there are a lot of, for example, the Chinese equivalent of Uber called Didi, they put up plastic sheets in between the driver and the passengers. They also put up signs that that their cars have been disinfected.
This could be a sign of what is to come in the U.S., but it will take a long time before things go back to normal.
Businesses are not all going to open at once. They're going to open in rounds. And the first rounds will be sort of the deferred essential things. We're going to go to the dentist. We're going to go to the doctor. We're going to do all of the things that we have to do, and we're 3 or 6 months behind. In the second phase, I think we're going to take care of ourselves. I think we're going to go get a haircut. We're going to go get our nails done. I think we're going to try to go to restaurants and have some food that we didn't make. You know, we're going to go to our favorite places. Then I think in the third and fourth phases, we're going to start to see more retailers open. I think the last thing to reopen, probably the fourth phase, will be things like the big manufacturing plants, where they have to bring in a lot of parts from a lot of different people. They've got to reassemble their workforce and get things cranked up. What we're not going to see is, okay, the virus is gone, flip the switch, everything's back to normal.